Well, hello, welcome on board to this year's first round of our webinar series, Questions on Literatures in English. I am Tiago, I will be your host tonight. For the next 2 hours, we shall discuss a very straightforward but tricky question: what does a poet laureate do? Many of you are probably familiar with Sir Godfrey Kneller's painting of a side-glancing John Dryden holding a laurel wreath, or have heard Amanda Gorman's reading of the hill we climbed in Joe Biden's inauguration. Professors Leland, McCleary, and John Milton will show us, however, how this venerable institution, the poet laureate, has evolved over centuries and discuss its multiple iterations across the globe. So I'd like to invite to start our discussion Professor John Milton, who is full professor at the University of São Paulo. John, you have the floor, or you have the mic. You need to turn on your microphone, John.
Thank you. Unfortunately, I don't have the picture of John Dryden. Maybe we can find it for later and show it. Okay, I'm going to share the screen. And here we are. Okay, can you everybody see? Yeah. Okay, so what does a poet laureate do? Let's just look at my screenshot from Wikipedia initially, where we have the list of poet laureates. I'm not going to read right through. You can see some famous names. In the middle of the page, well, you can see John Dryden was the very first poet laureate. In the middle of the page, you can see William Wordsworth. William Wordsworth was poet laureate right at the end of his life, following Robert Southey, the other Lake poet. And Wordsworth took the position as a kind of prize on the condition that he wouldn't need to write any poetry whatsoever, and he didn't write a single poem as poet laureate. However, he was followed by Tennyson, Alfred Lord Tennyson. You can see Tennyson wins the prize for longevity, staying 42 years as poet laureate, and really kind of re-established the post and wrote some of the most famous poems in the English language as poet laureate. I'm going to look at a couple of Tennyson's poems in a minute, and then these will be followed by looking at two of the more recent, or the most recent, poet laureates, Carol Ann Duffy and Simon Armitage. You can see both alive now, relatively young and very active. Okay, let's move on to the second one. Well, what does a poet laureate do then? The poet laureate of the United Kingdom is an honorary position appointed by the monarch, currently on the advice of the Prime Minister. And of course, the Prime Minister is also acts on the advice of university professors, etc. The role does not entail any specific duties, but there is an expectation that the holder will write verse for significant national occasions. What are significant national occasions? Well, the markers of one's life. I put here royal births, royal weddings, birthdays, and of course we have the considerable longevity of the royal family, and deaths. And in a few minutes, I'm going to be looking at a well-known poem, which is written quite recently, or last, just about a year ago, just under a few days under a year ago, by Simon Armitage, the present poet laureate, on the death of Prince Philip. Wars. Yeah, another of the poems I'll be looking at by Simon Armitage is on the present war in Ukraine, political poems, Brexit. I don't think there were any poems about Brexit or written by Poet Laureate. Sport, we'll see a poem by Caroline Duffy about David Beckham in a few minutes. The Poet Laureate earns an annual salary of £5,750, which is around 35,000 yen. So it's not so much, but of course the Poet Laureate will receive a large number of invitations. The poet, by being Poet Laureate, the number of books of poetry which will be sold by the laureate will of course go up, and it's a highly prestigious position. What is most interesting is that the Poet Laureate receives a butt of sack. What is a butt of sack? We'll see in a few minutes. Those of you who know your Shakespeare will remember that sack was the favorite drink, the favorite tipple of which character? Shakespeareans, put it on the chart. Which character? Butt of sack, Sir John Falstaff, of course. Sack, nowadays we call it sherry. So sherry, there's sweet sherry and there's dry sherry. And so a butt of sack, a barrel of sherry, around about 720 bottles of sherry. No, this is not a month, not a year. This is for the 10-year duration of the time, the 10-year duration of the time which the poet will remain Poet Laureate. And since 1999, this has become the norm. For obvious reasons, so John Masefield, who is the Poet Laureate, we can see here, if we go back here, you can see Sir John Masefield was Poet Laureate for 37 years, right at the end of his life when he was 88, and not producing very much good poetry. So now the 10-year stint of the Poet Laureate means basically that the laureate will be writing in his or her most productive years of their life. Okay, let's begin then. We have quite a lot to go through. I'm going to base this on comparing poems by Tennyson and Caroline Duffy and Simon Armitage. I'll be reading, these are all available also on internet, an ode on the death of the Duke of Wellington. If you look at the bottom, Duke of Wellington, a great English hero, commander of the British forces that defeated Napoleon at the Battle of Waterloo, one of the most famous battles in the history of England, and later Prime Minister. This is just the beginning of a long ode, a poem on the death of the Duke of Wellington. Bury the great Duke with an empire's lamentation. Let us bury the great Duke to the noise of the mourning of a mighty nation. Mourning when their leaders fall, warriors carry the warrior's pall, and sorrow darkens hamlet and hall. Where shall we lay the man whom we deplore? Here in streaming London's central roar, let the sound of those he wrought for, and the feet of those he fought for, echo round his bones forevermore. Lead out the pageant sad and slow, as fits an universal woe. Let the long procession go, and let the sorrowing crowd about it grow, and let the mournful martial music blow. The last great Englishman is low. Deplore had a different meaning. Deplore nowadays we use when we don't like something, we have a bad opinion. It also had the meaning of to be in mourning for somebody. I found that actually I would never use deplore like that. I was surprised to find it. You can see the tone of this poem, the lamentation of the great man, the great military leader, the greatness of the British Empire, etc. We can also find this militarism in one of the most famous poems in the English language, The Charge of the Light Brigade, from 1854. Okay. Charge of the Light Brigade. Half a league onward, all in the valley of death, rode the 600. Forward the Light Brigade, charge for the guns, he said. Into the valley of death rode the 600. Forward the Light Brigade, was there a man dismayed? Not though the soldier knew someone had blundered. There's not to make reply, there's not to reason why, there's but to do and die. Into the valley of death rode the 600. Cannon to right of them, cannon to left of them, cannon in front of them, volleyed and thundered, stormed at with shot and shell, boldly they rode and well, into the jaws of death, rode the 600. Flashed all their sabres bare, flashed as they turned in air, sabring the gunners there, charging an army wild, all the world wondered. Plunged in the battery smoke, right through the line they broke, Cossack and Russian, reeled from the sabre stroke, shattered and sundered. Then they rode back, but not the 600. Cannon to right of them, cannon to left of them, cannon behind them, volleyed and thundered. Stormed at with shot and shell, while horse and hero fell, they that had fought so well, came through the jaws of death, back from the mouth of hell, all that was left of them, left of 600. When can their glory fade? All the wild charge they made, all the world wondered. Honor the charge they made, honor the Light Brigade, noble 600. Okay, you can see the form of the poem is quite unusual. It is dactylic, beginning bum ba ba, bum ba ba, bum ba ba, bum ba ba. Very unusual, quite experimental. It has a kind of military beat to it. If you're interested in seeing this in Portuguese, it will be soon published by a student of mine, Pedro Mohalam, who is translating a selection of Tennyson's verse, which will be published by Luminuras soon. At the bottom of the page, you can see information there about the unsuccessful battle. A large number were killed, and the light cavalry that suffered a miscommunication in the chain of command, and the frontal assault resulted in a large number of soldiers dying. Well, so we find the Victorian, Tennyson is always associated with the Victorian people, and as the great Victorian poet, and we can see some of the qualities, sense of empire, sense of the greatness of the British Empire, and also a strong element of militarism, death in battle, etc. Topics which today and not at all popular. Okay, if we move on, let me see, where are we? If we move on now, let's move on to Simon Armitage, the present poet laureate. You can see information about him there. And born in the north of England in Huddersfield, a relatively modest background. He worked for a number of years as a probation officer, officiel d'acondicionnement, and writing poetry from a very early age. Working as a probation officer, moving to poetry, becoming professor of poetry at University of Leeds. Let's look at him. Aha, this is the butt This is the butt of sack. And you can see that one of the other tasks, as well as writing poetry, the poet laureate has the duty to drink wine. This is the butt of sack. I remember not so many, three or four years ago, I did an incredibly difficult translation for Portuguese wine company Port Wine in Douro. It was legal elements for the sale of wine in the 18th century. Incredibly difficult translation. I asked to be paid in wine. Unfortunately, it wasn't possible. I was hoping that somebody would deliver a butt of port to my door like this. Okay, Prince Philip, who you all remember, who died almost exactly a year ago. And let's look at this poetry, poem, which became rather well-known, rather famous at the time. And one of the characteristics of the poet laureate is that their poems are published. I don't have the slide I was looking for, no. The poems are published throughout the media, read on television, on radio, of course, internet today, and also published in popular tabloid newspapers, The Sun, The Mirror, you'll be familiar with. Normally the readers of The Sun and The Mirror have little familiarity with poetry, think the poetry is something not very day-to-day, something a bit effete, something a bit maybe even effeminate, but they read the poems published by the poet laureate on occasions such as the death of the Prince Philip. Now, Simon Armitage had just taken the job, just been in the job for just about a year, following Carol Ann Duffy. He had never met Prince Philip. And here we come to one of the characteristics, one of the problems of the poet laureate. The poet laureate in most cases will have little contact with the royal family. The poet laureate may have met on one or two occasions some of the members of the royal family, but it is nothing like a kind of house poet. The poet laureate will not live in Buckingham Palace and have tea and breakfast every day with the Queen. The poet laureate will continue their lives and be expected on certain formal occasions to write poems about happenings in the royal family, such as Prince Philip's death. So let's look at what Simon Armitage does in this case. He didn't know Prince Philip, he'd never met him. Of course, he knew of Prince Philip, and have probably followed him, and part of his job is to know what he's been doing. But let's see what he does. The Patriarch, it's interesting, it's not called Prince Philip, it's called the Patriarch. So initially we find it's all generalized. Let's see what he does. If you go on internet, you can find Simon Armitage reading this as well. The weather in the window this morning is snow, unseasonal singular flakes. A slow winter's final shiver. On such an occasion, to presume to eulogize one man is to pipe up for a whole generation. That crew whose survival was always the stuff of minor miracle, who came ashore in orange crate coracles, fought ingenious wars, finagled triumphs at sea, with flaming decoy boats and sidestepped torpedoes. Husbands to duty, they unrolled their plans across billiard tables and vehicle bonnets, regrouped at breakfast. What their secrets were was everyone's guess and nobody's business. Great-grandfathers from birth, in time they became both inner core and outer case, in a family heirloom of nesting dolls. Like evidence of early man, their boot prints stand in the hardened earth of rose beds and borders. They were sons of a zodiac out of zinc, with the solar year but turn their minds to the day's big science and heavy questions. To study their hands at rest was to picture maps, showing hatchured valleys and indigo streams, schemes of old campaigns and reconnaissance missions. Last of the great avuncular magicians, they kept their best tricks for the grand finale, disproving immortality and disappearing entirely. The major oaks in the woods start tuning up, and skies to come will deliver their tributes. But now, a cold April's closing moments, parachute slowly home. So by mid-afternoon, snow is recast with seed heads and thistle down. Well, you can see what Simon Armitage does. There's nothing particular about Prince Philip, the Duke of Edinburgh. He himself said that the last thing Prince Philip would want would be a sycophantic poem saying what a marvelous man he was. So what he does is make a generalization. Philip is typical, an archetype of his generation, men who fought in the Second World War, whose, with the references in the first paragraph here, who had great plans, they were ingenious, they were clever, they had a kind of military practical sense, they were going to live a long life. There are so many great grandfathers. He died at 99. I have two aunts more than 100. My mother's 93. And this idea of being practical, this idea of working, this idea of putting their minds to a lot of different questions, typical of Prince Philip. Very interesting to read about Prince Philip and his relationship with the royal family, wanting to be a great modernizer, and at times prevented by the Queen Mother. I'm sure everybody's listening has watched, or many people listening have watched The Crown on Netflix. If you haven't, I recommend it. All right, time is going. We don't have time to look in such great detail, but let's look at the war poem. Totally different from the Tennyson war poems. Of course, this is the most recent war. In Ukraine, you can see the colors, blue and yellow there. And this poem was written just a couple of weeks ago. So it's the, yeah, it's the Poet Laureate writing about war, but in a very different sense to Tennyson. As far as I know, there was no poem written by the Poet Laureate of the time, Ted Hughes, about the Falklands War. Resistance. It's war again. A family carries its family out of a pranged house under a burning thatch. The next scene smacks of archive newsreel. Platforms and trains, never again, never again. Toddlers passed over heads and shoulders, lifetimes stowed in luggage racks. It's war again, unmistakable smoke on the near horizon mistaken for thick fog. Fingers crossed. An old blue tractor tows an armored tank into no man's land. It's the ceasefire hour, Godspeed the columns of winter coats and fur-lined hoods. The high wire walk over buckled bridges, managing cases and bags, balancing east and west. Godspeed, it's war again. The woman in black gives sunflower seeds to the soldier, and says his marrow will nourish the national flower. In dreams, let bullets be birds, let cluster bombs burst into flocks. False news is news with a pity edited out. It's war again. An air raid siren can't fully mute the cathedral bells. Let's call that hope. Well, very, very different from the concept of glory, the militarism of Tennyson here, the uselessness of war, war coming again, a kind of hopelessness of war. However, in the midst of that, there is a certain hope, the seeds of the future, the birds rather than bombs. Let's call that hope. time is moving, so let's move on to Carol Ann Duffy, who preceded Simon Armitage as Poet Laureate. She was born just a couple of weeks before me. And Professor of Poetry, Manchester Metropolitan. She was Poet Laureate from 2009 to 19. The first woman, the first Scottish-born poet, and the first known LGBT poet to hold the position. Okay. And let's look a little bit about her. I'm not going to read right through this. This is a poem called Achilles for David Beckham. I'm not going to read everything on the left, but you can see there, if you glance over it, she wrote topical poems about climate change conference, banking crisis, about the fact that David Beckham had to drop out of the World Cup. You can see here, published in the Daily Mirror, treats modern celebrity culture as a kind of mythicization. And then the ash of the Icelandic volcano, Eyjafjallajökull, and a poem in honor of LGBTQ people who lost their lives because of AIDS. Achilles, for David Beckham. Myth's river, where his mother dipped him, fished him. Slippery golden boy flowed on, his name on its lips. Without him, it was prophesied. They would not take Troy. Women hid him, concealed him in girls' sarongs. Days of sweetmeats, spices, silver songs. But when Odysseus came with an athlete's build, a sword and a shield, he followed him to the battlefield. The crowds roar. It was sport, not war. His charmed foot on the ball. But then his heel. The poem was first published in the Daily Mirror. That's not part of the poem. I should have taken this way. Okay, you can see the way that the myth of Achilles, the Achilles heel, is mixed with David Beckham. One or two references I can mention here. There's one famous picture of David Beckham taken wearing a sarong. And of course, spices, what does spices remind you of? The Spice Girls, who were popular at the time of Beckham as well. And the way in which the myth of Achilles, Odysseus, is mixed also with the myth of David Beckham, who had to drop out of the 2010 World Cup because of his problem with his heel, his Achilles heel. You can see the way its contemporary element is mixed with the mythological element. And you can see the way, both in Carol Ann Duffy and Simon Armitage, the way in which they have, if you like, modernized the way in which the Poet Laureate writes, the topics they write about. And let's move on to one of her most famous poems, Rings, for the wedding of William and Kate, still together, still seem to be pretty happy together. Of course, poems about weddings when the couple have long divorced and begun to hate each other do not quite ring true. Rings, okay, the great symbol of the wedding, of marriage, ring. And ring has a large number of different meanings, different connotations, which she uses in this poem. Rings for both to say. I might have raised your hand to the sky to give you the rings surrounding the moon, or looked to twin the rings of your eyes with mine, or added a ring to the rings of a tree by forming a handheld circle with you, thee, or walked with you where a ring of church bells looped the fields, or kissed a lipstick ring on your cheek, a pressed flower, or met with you in the ring of an hour, and another hour. I might have opened your palm to the weather, turned, till your fingers were ringed in rain, or held you close. We were playing our song in the ring of a slow dance, or carved our names in the rough ring of a heart, or heard the ring of an owl's hoot as we headed home in the dark, or the ring, first thing, of chorusing birds waking the house, or given the ring of a boat rowing the lake, or the ring of swans monogamous, two, or the watery rings made by the fish as they leaped and splashed, or the ring of the sun's reflection there. I might have tied a blade of grass, a green ring for your finger, or told you the ring of a sonnet by heart, or brought you to a lichen ring found on a warm wall, or given a ring of ice in winter, or in the snow, sung with you the five gold rings of a carol, or stolen a ring of your hair, or whispered the word in your ear that brought us here, where nothing and no one is wrong. And therefore, I give you this ring. Okay, I think you can get most of the ways in which she has used ring, basically taking advantage of the enormous semantic variety of ring as a noun, also ring as a verb, to produce a very lovely poem. And again, nothing to do with the particular people. Extrapolating a concept of marriage, a symbol of the main symbol of the wedding, the ring. At no moment are either member of the couple mentioned. And you can see in the photo, this was recent trip to the West Indies, the Caribbean, which, if you read the press, was unsuccessful. If you follow the royal family, it seems that a number of Barbados just became a republic. Jamaica probably will. The royal family is seen as being out of date. I'm not sure if Simon Armitage will be writing a poem about the new republics leaving the Commonwealth. And I shall finish with a poem. Leland, you didn't know that Caroline Duffy wrote an official poem for Donald Trump's inauguration, did you?
No, I didn't.
Here it is. Swearing in, comb over, thatch fraud, rug rogue, lacquer lout, Twitter rat, tweet twat, tribe gob, muck spout. Sleaze surf, poke knave, bribe burk, bed swerver, hand mangler, kids mitts, thumb sucker, fist jerker, news maggot, lie monger, tongue trister, crap grubber, smell feast, guzzle chops, snout linger, burger blubber, tie treader, tan faker, draft dodger, piss douse, fraud hawker, golf plonker, bigot merchant, shite louse, mandrake mimican. Welcome to the White House. You can see some of them are explained here. Let's just look through. Burke, fool, prat, twit, in Cockney rhyming slang, Berkshire, hunt, cunt. Mimma Merkin, the deformed or freakish Persian or dwarf creature, Scottish English. Duffy wrote the poem using the Old English poetic format of kenning. A kenning is a compound word with a metaphorical meaning. Example, or steed instead of ship. What we're thinking of doing, as this poem is an enormous challenge to translate into any language, we are thinking of organizing a competition to translate this poem into Portuguese, which of course will be very difficult. It will be very interesting to see the solution. We are intending to do this with Cadernos de Literatura em Tradução, and also possibly Casa Guilherme de Almeida, and of course there will be prizes. I'm not sure where we are discussing the prizes. I don't think Donald Trump will offer a suit or tie of his, but we're just thinking about that, and if you receive information from the lists, you'll be receiving information for the competition, the concurso, shortly. Okay, and I've taken just a little bit more than my 30 minutes. Thank you very much, and we'll have plenty of time to chat afterwards. And I pass back to, I think it's Tiago, isn't it?
Thank you, John, for your sonically meaningful renderings of all these wonderful poets, of this wonderful poet.
I enjoy it.
Your voice was dripping with enthusiasm. it was really, really fun.
Stop sharing.
I would like to invite now Professor McCleary to discuss, to discuss now the embodiment of the figure or role of the poet laureate across the pond in North America. So we have just heard Professor Milton, discussing the long tradition of the poet laureate in Britain. Now I'd like to invite Professor McCleary. Thank you.
Thank you, Tiago. Thanks. Thank you, John, for inviting me. I must say that when I got this invitation, I was shocked. I thought, what? What? Poet laureate in the United States? I knew nothing about that. I had a vague idea that there might be a poet laureate, but as I was growing up, this had no register to me, and I studied English. I knew that there were poet laureates off there in England, but I thought, well, that has nothing to do with the United States. We got rid of the king, and the poet laureate goes with him. And so it really had no register. And I thought, well, okay, I'll find out about this. So this has been an interesting adventure. In fact, I did ask about 15 of my high school and college buddies what they thought, what they knew about poets laureate, and universally, they all said almost nothing. So this has been an interesting exploration. I've come to change my idea substantially. Let me share my screen here. So here we go. Case of the United States. I'm going to talk about these topics. Since I knew that poet laureates are poets who are supposed to write poems on august occasions of the state, I thought, well, this is a place to start. In fact, when John invited me, he did mention Robert Frost in his role as the poet at Kennedy's inauguration. And some of my friends who responded to my query also mentioned Robert Frost. So that was a place to begin. But none of them were poet laureates. In fact, there is such a thing as poet laureate. that derived from a previous role of consultant in poetry at the Library of Congress. So I'll talk about that. I'll talk about the difference between consultant and poet laureate. And then there, I found out that there is a whole range of state poet laureates. Different states have had poet laureates, poets laureate, long before the United States as a nation did. Not only that, but there are city poet laureates, there are youth poets laureate, there, and there are, of course, informal poets laureates. So I don't know if I'll be able to get through all of them, but you'll see that there are poets laureate all over the place in the United States, and I had no idea. So here's where we can start. Poets at inaugurations, and the first one in all the 200 years of the United States, the first time that we know of that a poet was asked to read a poem at an inauguration was in 1961 at the inauguration of John Kennedy. Now, it turns out that Robert Frost did not read the poem that he wrote for this occasion, which is shown here on the right. The wind was strong and the sun was in his eyes and he couldn't read it and he didn't know it by heart. Thankfully, he left it aside because it's really pretty terrible and I've never heard anybody quote from it ever. And he ended up citing or quoting a poem by memory of his from 1941. And I'm going to show you that now because I always thought that was a pretty good poem, patriotic, and I've read it again and have quite changed my feeling about the poem. The land was ours before we were the land's. She was our land more than 100 years before we were her people. She was ours in Massachusetts, in Virginia, but we were England's, still colonials, possessing what we were still unpossessed by, possessed by what we now no more possessed. Something we were more withholding made us weak. Something we were withholding made us weak until we found out that it was ourselves we were withholding from our land of living and forthwith found salvation in surrender. Such as we were, we gave ourselves outright. The gift, the deed of gift, was many deeds of war to the land, vaguely realizing westward, but still unstoried, artless, unenhanced, such as she was, such as she would become. Now I'm going to show you this because this points out some of the items in here that really make my skin crawl. The land was ours before we were the land. She was our land more than 100 years before we were her people. As if, yes, that land was ours, and no question. And then the comment, salvation in surrender. But of course, he's implying a certain kind of surrender, but we wonder whether there wasn't another kind of surrender that was behind our domination of this continent. The deed of gift was many deeds of war, also makes my skin crawl. To the land vaguely realizing westward, which recalls manifest destiny, but still unstoried, artless, unenhanced, as if there was no culture here before we came and conquered this continent. Okay, so that we're going to come back to this later because, you'll see. So keep that in mind. Other poets of the inauguration, I'm not going to talk about them specifically, but I want you to see there are only six, these two at Barack Obama's, a Black woman and a second Black woman and a gay man. And of course, the one who Jag even mentioned because she became so famous, Amanda Gorman. I'm just going to play you. No, I'm going to skip this. If we want to, we can come back. and look at some of this, but it's quite interesting. In fact, she is the first poet laureate to have spoken at an inauguration, but she wasn't poet laureate because of that. And it was because she was a youth poet laureate in Los Angeles, of Los Angeles. Okay, consultants in poetry were established in the Library of Congress in 1937. And they were established as kind of a librarian, a reference librarian or a specialist. But they gradually didn't really have much to do in that capacity, and they weren't really prepared for it. They were prepared as poets. So they ended up becoming more a means of sponsoring poetry, promoting poetry, and giving poetry readings and lectures and conferences. But they weren't considered poet laureates, and they weren't expected to necessarily perform at state occasions or write poetry related to anything having to do with the government necessarily. These are not paid for by public funds. They're paid for by a gift. So here we've had 29 of these. William Carlos Williams was appointed but didn't serve. And you can see here that the first woman was appointed in 1945. The first African-American was appointed in 1976, and the first African-American woman in 1985. You can see here there were 6 women out of 29 or 30. That was about 1/5 at that time, at the beginning. I'm going to talk about just one of these, or 2 of them actually, but I'll read a poem from one. And that is Elizabeth Bishop. And I choose her partly because she's probably better known to a Brazilian audience than she is to an American audience. Here she is in her office as consultant in poetry in the attic of the Library of Congress. And it shows the Capitol out her window. She had a very tough time in this role. And among other things that she didn't really adapt to was visits that she made to a certain poet who was across town at the time, who was a kind of anti-laureate. This is the man. He was hospitalized to keep from being accused of treason so he was there in the hospital, St. Elizabeth's Hospital, and it had been a kind of habit for these consultants to go visit and take books from the library, and she found that very distressing. And in fact, she wrote a poem on it, and that's what I'm going to read. Visits to St. Elizabeth's. This is the house of Bedlam. This is the man that lies in the house of Bedlam. This is the time of the tragic man that lies in the house of Bedlam. This is the wrist watch telling a time of the talkative man that lies in the house of Bedlam. This is a sailor wearing the watch that tells the time of the honored man that lies in the house of Bedlam. This is the roadstead of all board, all of board, reached by the sailor wearing the watch that tells the time of the old brave man that lies in the house of Bedlam. These are the years of the walls. I can't read it, just a second. These are the years of the walls of the ward, the winds and clouds of the sea of board, sailed by the sailor wearing the watch that tells the time, the cranky old man that lies in the house of Bedlam. This is a Jew in a newspaper hat that dances weeping down the ward. over the creaking sea of board, beyond the sailor winding his watch that tells the time of the cruel man that lies in the house of Bedlam. Going on, I just wanted to show you, this was the last consultant in poetry, a Black woman. She is really amazing. She was also a poet laureate, but of Illinois, the state of Illinois. But she's not considered a poet laureate of the United States because she wasn't appointed under that title. So going on, we then have, as of 1985, with a name change, we have poet laureate consultants in poetry. And this title is supposed to be applied only to people who assume the role under this title, but in fact, all of these consultants are often called poets laureate. Here are the names. There are 24 or so. And again, you can see that there's a increase in women, there's an increase of minorities, and the current poet laureate is the first Native American. This is the first poet laureate that I ever heard about, Rita Dove. And I'm going to read a poem that she wrote for an official occasion. It was at the inauguration of the restored Capitol Statue of Freedom at the 200th anniversary of laying the Capitol cornerstone in 1993. This one has a translation. Lady Liberty among us. Don't lower your eyes or stare straight ahead to where you think you ought to be going. Don't mutter, oh no, not another one. Get a job, fly a kite, go bury a bone. With her old-fashioned sandals, with her leaden skirts, with her stained cheeks and whiskers and heaped up trinkets, she has risen among us in blunt reproach. She has fitted her hair under a hand-me-down cap and spruced it up with feathers and stars. Slung over her shoulder, she bears the rainbowed layers of charity and murmurs, all of you, even the least of you. Don't cross to the other side of the square. Don't think another item to fit on a tourist's agenda. Consider her drenched gaze, her shining brow, she who has brought mercy back into the streets and will not retire politely to the potter's field. Having assumed the thick skin of this town, its gritted exhaust, its sun scorch and blear, she rests in her weathered plumage, big bone, resolute. Don't think you can ever forget her. Don't even try. She's not going to budge. No choice but to grant her space, crown her with sky, for she is one of the many, and she is each of us. This is then the current poet laureate. She's Native American, and she has adopted a project which some poet laureates have been doing. Her project is Living Nations, Living Worlds. And what she's doing with this is reclaiming the poetry of the Native Americans in the various regions of the country, the various languages. So taking another look here, we can remind ourselves that this was not our land. And it was not unstoried or artless or unenhanced. Okay, state poet laureates. You know there are 50 states, so there should be about 50 poets laureate. Well, not quite. but you can see how they've been increasing over the decades. There was a surge in the 20s and 30s, and then there's been a kind of constant increase in the number of states' poet laureates. Not all states have them, and some states have had them and no longer do. Here are four states that don't. And it's interesting that three of them had them and then gave them up. The case of New Jersey is interesting because they gave them up explicitly because of one of their poets laureate who went bad, so to speak. This was Amiri Baraka, who did a public reading after the 9/11, and it shocked so many people that he was asked to step down. He did not. And so they abolished the post. I'm going to just play the beginning of this.
Somebody blew up America. All thinking people oppose terrorism, both domestic and international. But one should not be used to cover the other. Somebody blew up America. They say it's some terrorist, some barbaric Arab in Afghanistan. It wasn't our American terrorists, it wasn't the Klan, or the skinheads, or the them that blows up nigger churches or reincarnates us on death row. It wasn't Trent Lott, or David Duke, or Giuliani, or Shumla, Helms retiring. It wasn't the gonorrhea in costume, the white sheet diseases that have murdered black people, terrorized reason and sanity, most of humanity, as they pleases.
Okay, going on, we could come back to that if anybody wants to. Now, that was not a poet laureate of, just a second.
Somebody blew.
That was not a U.S. poet laureate, but the poet laureate of the state of New Jersey. Here's the current poet laureate of Wisconsin, of Louisiana, of Texas, Kentucky. As I was discovering these people, I started reading up on them, and I invite you to do that too, because they're also such fascinating people. So cities can have their own poet laureates too. Here we have Albuquerque, San Antonio, San Francisco that have poet laureates. Other cities may have a youth poet laureate, such as Chicago, New York City, Atlanta, Seattle, Memphis, Denver. Some cities have both poet laureates and youth poet laureates. Boston, Los Angeles, Houston, Dallas, St. Louis, Phoenix. So I estimate, a low estimate, is that there are always at least 100 poets laureate active in the United States at any one time, counting all of the state poet laureates and the city poet laureates and county poet laureates, and informal poet laureates, of course, but many of these would be emeritus, because laureate has also a common informal usage where you call somebody who is associated with some style or region or place a laureate of that. So here we have the poet laureate of the Negro race, he's been called, or the poet laureate of Harlem, Langston Hughes. Here I found this, Edwin Arlington Robinson, called the America's poet laureate of unhappiness. It's just something that somebody made up. And the Confederacy also had its poet laureates. There were three of them. They were all unofficial poet laureates, poets laureate, but here they are. They've all been called at various times poet laureates. And even neighborhoods. neighborhoods of New York City, for example, have their own poet laureates. I found this, that Steve Cannon was named Poet Laureate of the Lower East Side in New York City. The Lower East Side is famous for a lot of art and poetry, but particularly the New York, New Yorican movement. So I want to show you here, a poem by my candidate for the first poet laureate of Lower East Side, Miguel Pinheiro. And I want to play for you this, his poem, a Lower East Side poem. This reading is not him himself, it's a group of poets filmed for the movie Pinheiro.
I'm up on the tenement sky to dream my lungs out till I cry, then scatter my ashes through the Lower East Side. So let me sing my song tonight. Let me feel out of sight. And let our eyes be dry when they scatter my ashes through the Lower East Side. From Houston to 14th Street, from 2nd Avenue to the Mighty D, here the hustlers and suckers meet the faggots and freaks. We'll all get high on the ashes that have been scattered through the Lower East Side. Ba, da, 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 ba, da, 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 da. There's no other place for me to be. There's no other place that I can see. There's no other town around that brings you up or keeps you down. A thief, a junkie I've been, committed every known sin, Jews and Gentiles, bums and men of style. Runaway child, police shooting wild mothers, futile wails, pushers making sales, dope wheelers and cocaine dealers, smoking pot, streets are hot, feet off those who bleed to death. Bam, 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 bam,
oh, that's true, bam, bam, oh, that's true, bam, oh, that is true, but this ain't no lie when I ask that my ashes be scattered through the Lower East Side.
So here I am, yeah, look at me.
I stand proud, as you can see, pleased to be from the Lower East Side.
A street fight man, a problem this land.
I am the philosopher of the criminal mind, a dweller of prison time, a cancer of Rockefeller's ghetto side. This concrete tomb is my home.
To belong, to survive, you gotta be strong.
You can't be shy, lest without request, someone will scatter your ashes through the Lower East Side.
I don't want to be buried in Puerto Rico. I don't want to rest in some Long Island cemetery. I want to be near the stabbing, shooting, gambling, fighting, unnatural dying, and new birth crying. So please, when I die, don't take me far away. Just keep me nearby. Just take my ashes and scatter them throughout the Lower East Side.
I'm up on the
Okay, unfortunately, here's the text of the poem, the words of the poem, but I couldn't show them at the same time. So we can come back to this if anybody has a question. So that's, I'll wind that up. Thank you.
Thank you, Leland. You know, for someone who has said, who has never heard anything about a bottom.
Well, I figure what the United States lacked in time dimension and is made up for.
Yes, you know. there are layers upon layers of poets laureate in America.
Who would have guessed? I certainly did not have any clue.
No, thank you. It was a very thorough, informed, and informative lecture. I really enjoyed it very much. We have multiple questions, you know, from our audience. I'll read them. I'll share them with you, and then afterwards, I would invite you know, everyone who's watching us to you may pose questions either in English or Portuguese. I'll be more than glad to translate them. I think that the first comment here is by a regular in our webinars. This is a dot in kangaroo, who says that John's voice is always so soothing. So we have a fan. John, I think people have enjoyed your rendering of poetry. And Giselle Walkoff said that amazing how poet Duffy sounds popular in spite of the laureate in her title there. Maybe a sign of the times. Do you want to comment on that, John?
Yeah. These traditional positions survive, as does the royal family, by changing according to the times. So, I think what we can see is that the idea of the poet laureate has become much more popular because of the choice of interesting contemporary poets who are not stuffy, who do not write about the glories of the royal family, but write about very contemporary incidents and happenings. As the royal family has survived by changing, and in recent weeks with the failure, the big failure, the trip of Kate and William to the Caribbean, this has shown that the royal family has not been able to fall behind on realizing that a number of the Caribbean states are moving towards independence from the Commonwealth. But in general terms, the royal family has been able to change, has been able to modernize, has become less stuffy. Even you can see this in the way they speak. William speaks not with the posh BBC received pronunciation accent like that of Tiago, but rather with what we call estuary English, slightly London, Southeast England. So, you know, very interesting interesting times to see what will happen to this Commonwealth, which is an association of states which were formerly part of the empire. The Queen was very proud. Now she seems to be handing it over to Charles and William. Will it survive? There are the Commonwealth Games, a kind of equivalent of Olympic Games, which will take place in July, August, in my home city of Birmingham, but I hear critiques from Commonwealth states about the distribution of vaccine for COVID, that being members of the Commonwealth didn't help them one little bit whatsoever. So, you know, interesting times, interesting to see what will happen, but I think I'll just show a couple of slides again, which I got lost. Let me show a couple of slides. Sorry, what's the question?
You just mentioned COVID, you know, and are there poems about COVID, the COVID pandemic, by the current poet?
I haven't seen them. It's interesting. I haven't. As far as I know, because Carol Ann Duffy handed over to Simon Armitage just before. He became poet just before COVID took place. There is an interesting poem which he engraved on an anti-cancer tablet. I'll find the reference to this. I think you can see the screen again. Two slides I have here. The bottle it. The Queen has her own poet who she pays with 720 bottles of sherry when they are appointed. This gives the idea it's the Queen's own poet. It gives the idea that the poet is living with the Queen, when in fact they have little contact. I mean, it'd be an interesting idea. Give the give the Poet Laureate a room at Buckingham Palace or Windsor Castle and see what they make of that, and have dinner and tea with the Queen. And we can see here, should the Poet Laureate have to write about the royal birth? This is Princess Charlotte, who, this is, when is this? This is 7 years ago. Interesting to see the dialogues about this. I'll find that, I'll put it on chat, the poem about a cancer tablet, which was actually written on the tablet which Simon Armitage wrote. I'll stop sharing.
Thank you, John. And there are other questions. I think Giselle has a question about Leland's lectures, which is, Poets Laureate in the UK are nominated by the Crown, whereas in the US, who chooses them? The National Library or State Library Councils or an association? Who gives the laurel to the to the right. incumbent poet?
Usually, it's either the, in the case of the Poets Laureate, federal, at the federal level, those are appointed by the Librarian of Congress. But of course, he has a commission that makes a short list or makes a list and recommends one of these people to be appointed, and then he normally just appoints that person. So it's not his own personal decision. It's a decision that's informed by a committee. And the same thing happens at the state level. It's usually the governor who appoints the Poet Laureate, but he always has some kind of council, arts council or humanities council, who will make a recommendation or maybe give him three names to choose from, something like that.
You've mentioned Leland, that I think it was in Massachusetts, that a Poet Laureate could not be impeached, but can Poet Laureate be impeached on a federal level? Or no, should they be forced or compelled to resign?
No, they could be, I guess they could be fired.
Yeah, or impeached.
They could be sidelined. It's an interesting, William Carlos Williams is an interesting case as a consultant. He was nominated, he was named, but he never assumed. And I haven't been able to find out why. It may have been for some political reason. It may have been that he decided that this wasn't for him. But I haven't discovered why. But again, aside from this case of New Jersey, I don't have any other information on Poets Laureate that have been removed.
Yeah, we have other questions here. I think that Louise, I've just missed. I have scrolled on. Here, Louise has asked that, how does Professor Milton sees the techniques present-day Poets Laureate use? Is it fair to say that they rely more on semantics, wordplay, than on metric and rhythm?
To a certain extent, I mean, this is what we find. To a great extent, yes, but in a number of the poems, both of Armitage Caroline Duffy and the previous poem, Andrew Ocean, we find that the traditional poetic forms, such as the sonnet, blank verse, are used, but in a light way. So the blank verse doesn't always have ba-bum, 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 ba-bum. Sometimes you find an extra syllable. Sometimes you find a line with fewer feet. sometimes you find a mixture of the iambic pentameter with the iambic tetrameter. The forms are still there, but they become much more flexible. Unfortunately, we didn't have a time to make an in-depth study, but if you look at the poems we looked at again, you can find a number of elements such as internal rhyme, occasional end rhyme. And if we look at the poem, let me just look at it for 1 minute, of Simon Armitage, the poem, the Patriarchs is more or less blank verse. The weather in the window this morning is snow and seasonal singular flakes, a slow winter's final shiver, and such an occasion is more or less blank verse with a little bit of variety. It is not ba-boom, 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 but that is the basic form plus a little bit of variety. If we look at his second poem we looked at, it's War Again, A Family. Basically, there are stanzas of three lines, usually always with the second line rather longer. It's War Again, A Family carries its family out of a pranked house. So we find the first and the third line, it's War Again, A Family, trimeter, six syllables. We find the second line in each of the three-line stanzas much longer, more or less an iambic pentameter. So just to sum up what I've been saying, traditional poetic forms still remain, but they have become much more flexible.
I have a question, if I may. I think to both of you, you've quoted from Carol Ann Duffy's poem John Achilles, which is a poem by a Scotswoman to an English football player, and Leland, you've quoted Frost's The Gift Outright, and I think that both these poems, they illuminate a sort of tension that is at the core of the institution, tradition, position, figure, role, you name it, of the poet laureate today. Is it possible today that a poet may speak to the entire nation in a time such as ours of devolution, such as in Britain, or identity politics, which is very salient and vocal in the US? So I would like to hear both of you, you know, on that, whether it is possible to have a sort of poet who speaks for the entire nation as a sort of almost entity in a time such as ours, in which group identity seems more important than sort of national identity. Thank you.
Can they? I don't know. But I think the great desire of a lot of people is that they could, is that they might, is that it would be possible for them to find a way to communicate to the nation as a whole. And I think that's probably what is behind the poem of the inauguration, such as Amanda's poem, is this desire, this an attempt to find a way to speak to the nation as a whole and overcome the divisions. I think that's a general feeling that you hear politicians and the president of the United States, current president, a voice quite a bit, is this desire to find a language that can unify.
You're never going to be able to speak for the whole nation, but if you can speak for a large number of people in the nation, and then I think you're successful. It's quite clear that Carol Ann Duffy takes a somewhat socialist stance, although never anti-royal family, never Republican. We can say the same thing of Simon Armitage. Almost certainly they both probably vote for the Labour Party. However, Carol Ann Duffy was extremely successful, appealed to a large number of people who would never think of opening a book of poetry. These people read her poems in the sun, in the mirror, listened to them on television, on the radio, and of course today on the internet. So I think perhaps this is the success, making poetry appeal to many people who would never think of reading a poem. Carol Ann Duffy did this, Simon Armitage seems to be doing it. I think this is whether, certainly Amanda Gorman managed to do this. And I think this is the big success. You know, obviously the poets are vetted before they're appointed, you know, to make sure they're not anti-royal family or anything like that. But, you know, it doesn't matter. It's all the better if they even belong to certain minorities, LGBT, vote for the Labour Party. That's no problem.
Making poetry is a sort of instrument for nation building.
Yeah, you know, this nation building sounds a bit kind of 19th century.
or 1990s, or the early 2000s, actually.
Yeah, you said Scottish. She was born in Scotland, but she does not have a Scottish accent. She lived all her life. Her family moved to Stafford in the North Midlands. So, you know, she doesn't seem Scottish. I don't think she's ever lived in Scotland, a part of the enormous Scottish diaspora. Talking about Scotland, in both Scotland, Wales, there is a equivalent of the Poet Laureate. In Scotland, it's called the Macar. At the moment, Liz Lockhead, who writes a lot of her poetry, not in Gaelic, but in Scots Lalans, dialect of English. Lalans means lowlands. Macar, you can see, maker. The Welsh national poet writes his poetry, or they have to write it, in Welsh. And you could see, in the films, you could see something of this. Both the Scottish Macar and the Welsh national poet are very much public poets, giving performances, as we could see in the film The American Poets. The Poet Laureate of the United Kingdom does not have to make any public performances. Although if you go to the internet, you'll find both Carol Ann Duffy and Simon Armitage reading their poetry. But there's no occasion like that of Amanda Gorman, the inauguration, when there's a very, very important public occasion. So, you know, you have this about public poetry, private poetry. The Poet Laureate does not have to make public poetic performances.
Thank you. I would like to invite now my fellow colleagues of this webinar series, the organizing committee of this webinar series, Solange, Patricia, and Daniel, whether you would like to post questions or make
yes,
comments.
I would like to, to make a question. Here I am.
Hi. Daniel is speaking from his English kitchen in London.
Yes, I would like to begin by apologizing, two apologies, one for arriving late. I had an event in my institute that I could not arrive in time, sorry. And other for the scenario, because it's the only place where people cannot hear me. So I have to keep noise to a minimum. So, well, to Professor Leland, if you could, I don't know if you did the research on this and the connections between Elizabeth Bishop and Manuel Bandeira, if you can like say something more of this, because obviously something that attracts Brazilian audience, if I'm not mistaken, she translated Mano Bandeira. I know that Bandeira wrote a chronicle, yes, on her. And also another question, following up from Thiago's, this idea of how we elect, how can we think of a poet to represent the whole nation? And as you were saying, so you presented, which was very curious to me, poet laureates for a state, a city, a county, a neighborhood. So becoming very more individualized, more localized rather than national. Do you think this it's a phenomenon, again, like more recent, or has to do more with perhaps a democratic aspect of United States that would distinguish? I don't think we have this in England. Maybe John could comment, a poet laureate of a county, or, I don't know, a borough here in London. So these two things, if you could say something more about the relationship between Elizabeth Bishop and Bandeira, and again, maybe explain a little bit more of why, if it's something new, that you're becoming more localized in terms of having a poet that will represent, again, not the nation, but more specific groups and places. Thank you. I think we're not hearing you.
Leland, you need to turn on.
Leland, yeah.
Can you hear me now? Yes.
Yes.
I can kind of combine these two questions. I just right off the bat, I can tell you that no, I know nothing about Elizabeth Bishop's relation to the translation of Bandeira. So I'll have to let somebody else speak to that. But it was curious to me that one of the nicest things for her during her tenure as consultant in poetry was receiving Dylan Thomas from England to give a tour. He came to give his first tour while she was consultant. So she met him and they got along famously. And this tour of his is attributed to this tour is attributed the growing interest in poetry, in public readings of poetry and performance poetry. So that kind of leads into your second question. I think, as you noticed in the examples that I gave, there is a very public aspect to these poets laureate, whether at the national level where they get up with the inauguration, for example, or a poet does, or at the state or local level. This is seen as understood as a kind of educational venture or service. They're educating people, not only in the arts, in poetry specifically, but in the values of that might be attainable through the use of this medium. And so there are always having public readings and in various kinds of venues. And during COVID, of course, it was very much online. I don't know how much that your question that answers.
Yeah, I can come in with something. I certainly recommend the film about Elizabeth Bishop and Lothar Macedo, their affair by Bruno Barreto, Flores Raras, with Gloria Pires playing Lothar Macedo Suarez. I don't know about. I know Elizabeth Bishop did some translations, including part of Severino, but she didn't do it all. I don't know about her translations of Bandeira. In fact, actually, she never learned Portuguese so well, although she lived here for quite a long time. Interesting, her dislike of Ezra Pound. Why was that exactly? I wonder. Leland, do you have any ideas?
When was it?
When was what?
Did you ask when?
Yeah, no. Why did she hate Ezra Pound so much?
Well, I don't know. He was a very cranky person, like she
said.
He was a very difficult person to get along with, and he was, of course, under duress. He'd been declared insane, and he was. It was important for him to maintain that diagnosis. It was a very difficult situation going there and having to deal with them. Other consultants in poetry had also been doing that, but she at least registers that in a poem.
Yeah, I'm looking here on the internet. I'm finding something on.
There's a comment here.
Yeah, there's a comment by Gisele Walkoff. She says that Bandeira and Bishop translated each other, and she does recommend the edition, the complete poems by Farrar, Straus, and Giroux, published in New York. In this great edition, Gisele says, there is a whole session called Translations from the Portuguese, with poems by Bandeira, Jean Cabral de Melonato, Joaquim Cardoso, Drummond, Vinicius de Moraes, etc. It was first published in 1979. Thank you so much, Gisele, with this precious bit of information.
I'm also reading here that Bandeira actually translated at least one poem by Bishop.
Solange, Patricia would like to pose questions. We have a question by Renata, who says that she wonders how sensitive could be the nomination of a poet laureate, thinking of Ted Hughes and Sylvia Plath, of the Ted Hughes and Sylvia Plath affair. Could John comment on that?
Yeah. I was looking, when I was preparing this talk, I was looking through a number of Ted Hughes' poems, which I found much below the standard of his best work. Rather long, rather wandering, writing about the Queen Mother. And Hughes, quite surprisingly, was quite a strong royalist. I didn't like what I saw. The poems I saw on anniversaries of the royal family lacked his wit, lacked his bite, lacked his power. I was rather disappointed by them. Have a look at them, Renata. I chose deliberately not to use them because I didn't like them, and I found the poems of Simon Armitage and Caroline Duffy much better. Indeed, a large number of poets who've been poet laureate have written some of their worst poems as poet laureate. John Betjeman, who wrote a lot about traditional England, wrote some very bad poems, particularly about the wedding of Princess Anne and Captain Mark Phillips, which is rather embarrassing to look at, particularly when you read it in retrospect, when their marriage broke up after just 6 or 7 years. This is the problem about writing poems saying how lovely the couple are when they get married. It's not that easy, is it? What is the poet laureate going to write about? And I hope I showed you poems which I find are very successful by a kind of extrapolation, using that particular moment and using the symbol of rings in the case of the poem on the wedding of William and Kate, and also using Prince Philip as a representative of a generation of men, many of whom had done similar things to Prince Philip. I don't think it would have been very popular if I'd chosen a lot of the bad poems written by poet laureates. Maybe we can have, no, I don't think that would be very popular. I was going to say we have another session on bad poems, but no, I'm not going to propose that.
Solange, Patricia.
I have another question.
Yes, Daniel.
If I may.
Yes.
Thank you.
You have the kitchen.
I have the kitchen. So, John, you said that you can have a poet laureate from various political spectrum, but they all have to be, or they cannot be anti-monarchists. Yeah. In the case of United States, Professor Leland, would it be possible to have a poet laureate who stand for a very radical political stance that doesn't fit both in Democrats or Republicans? You said that William Carlos Williams didn't accept the nomination, probably for political reasons. So would you say this, that you would either have to be in one of those two parties?
No, not necessarily. The first criteria is your poetry, normally, because this committee is made up of poets and literary people, and they're looking at how much you published and what your reception has been. But also they're looking at how well you can perform these functions, these educative functions that they expect from the poet laureate. There are some states that actually require you to be a good public speaker, that have a public performance. But the example I gave you of Leroy Jones is one example of a poet who was out of touch with his state, or he was too radical, basically, for the governor, and the governor wanted to fire him, but couldn't. So I'm sure that happens, but there is this vetting process, and it involves a number of people, so they try to find somebody who, you know, one of the things that surprised me about this and that I tried to show in my selection was that the poet laureates are very often not very much in tune with the governments of the state. Of course, you would never expect the governor of Texas to have chosen that particular Latino poet laureate. And that's so true in other cases. So that's why it's important that these poet laureates be selected through a process that involves many other people, not just the governor. In the olden days, it was very much more a governor's thing. He would sometimes even choose somebody who had, in fact, there was one case where a governor chose apparently a friend of the family who had only published poetry, books of poetry by paying for the publication. So they weren't vetted in any way. And again, there was an attempt to remove her, but that was impossible.
Yeah, these things pass through a large number of committees. Obviously, you're not going to choose a poet who has strong anti-royal family background, although it doesn't matter if they're from a minority group, all the better, even. And Carol Ann Duffy achieved a large amount of publicity because of her LGBT background and the fact she was born in Scotland. When Simon Armitage was inaugurated as poet laureate, he was told that in his 10-year period as poet laureate, which I think has been an enormous positive change, No longer do you get poet laureates who are 85, 90, 95, who are gaga. How do you say in English? Gaga? Gaga. Gaga in English. How do you say in the States? Gaga. Gaga. And so this has been an enormous positive point. And Simon Armitage was told that during his tenure as poet laureate, there would probably be a number of world-changing events. We saw one last year in the death of the Duke of Edinburgh, Prince Philip. The Queen herself is 95. Let's see what's going to happen in the next years.
Well, thank you.
And of course, sorry, just to finish the point, just to add something else. And of course, the day that the Queen does pass away, all the world will be anxiously waiting, expecting, looking forward to the poem which Simon Armitage, or if the Queen survives another 8 or 9 years, the poet laureate afterwards will be obliged to write.
Would this ever happen?
No, probably this is a poem like Obituaries that has been written long before the event.
We say, do not tempt fate.
Yeah.
Gisele, she has commented about, she's just made a very interesting comment when I asked you about the output by poets laureates on COVID. She said that many Irish poets have recently written about COVID, such as Celia Dufresne, with a whole book and poems about the topic in Portugal too. I think we are heading towards the end of this session, but I would like to ask you whether you What do you know about whether such institution, the Poet Laureate, whether it has been exported to all the countries that formerly belonged or were part of the British Empire? Do we have Poet Laureate in Australia, in India, especially in post-colonial societies, which have been for the past decades highly invested in nation building? I think that the role of the poet laureate would be very important and very salient. I would like to know whether you...
I looked briefly through the list of countries, and many countries have occasionally had a poet laureate, often installed by a dictator to extol his deeds and qualities. This, of course, is the disadvantage of the poet laureate. I didn't really see any post-colonial countries who had a kind of an official poet laureate. I think it was something that was always associated with something which new republics wanted to get away from. And we saw an example in the Tennyson poems. Just like to repeat what I said earlier, Pedro Mohalam, who I think I saw his name, who's listening, his translations of selection of Tennyson's poem, the Kraken and other poems, will be published by Editore Luminuris in the near future. This is the first, surprisingly enough, translation of a book-length translation of Tennyson's poems. I don't know of translations of Carol Ann Duffy, Simon Armitage. Interesting to... We have any translators in the audience? Interesting to think about. And I'd like to mention again the concours, or the competition we're organizing to translate that very difficult poem describing President Donald Trump. Nobody mentioned that in the chat. Well, yes, there's no question on that.
Actually, Gisele has commented. She said that the phrase or image "tan faker" as absolutely marvelous. <Yeah. laughs> I think that's the only thing that is that isn't fake in Donald Trump.
Tan faker isn't fake.
I think it has been carefully curated throughout the decades.
So we'll be sending more information on this competition, on this concurso, in the near future to the various lists. I have a lot of lists. I send out information on translation, events connected to translation. Send me a mail, jmilton@usp.br. If you can, Leland, was your sister watching? Do you know?
We can't hear.
I don't know.
Oh no, she didn't send any questions. Okay, and thank everybody. I think I'm thanking again and hand over to Tiago.
You may thank everybody, John.
Okay,
you
thank are, everybody.
You are our professor laureate.
Thank you. Okay, so we'll be sending out information on future events in the next few days. We're just deciding on the next event, which will be at the end of next month. I'd like to thank Fabio and for helping us, and everybody who's helped in organizing this event. Okay, bye bye for me. And
bye bye. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you. I would like to thank our audience who has watched us throughout these 2 hours discussing a very Byzantine topic, which was, however, very interesting, you know. Thank you, everyone, for watching us. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.